السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهديه واقتدى بسنته إلى يوم الدين وبعد. Respected honored scholars, علماء, elders, beloved brothers, mothers and sisters, we begin by praising Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, our creator, our sustainer, our cherisher, provider. We send countless blessings, salutations upon our leader and master Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his honorable companions, his household, and those who follow him. Friends and elders, Allah has made the lives of all prophets exemplaries for humanity in its entirety. Apart from the fact that we seek guidance from the pronouncements of prophets, from the sayings of prophets, we equally draw guidance from the supplications of prophets and the du'as of prophets. What were the du'as that the different prophets had made? And I want to share with you one du'a of one Nabi of Allah, Nabi Dawood alayhi salam. Dawood alayhi salam used to make this du'a daily, which sums up the desires of a person both in this world and in akhirah. He used to say, Allahumma inni as'aluka lisanan dhakira. That, oh Allah, I ask you for such a tongue which is constantly moist with your praises. Wa qalban shakira. And O Allah, bless me with such a heart which is an embodiment of your gratitude. Wa lisanan dhakira. And O Allah, bless wa badanan sabira. And bless me with such a body that will persevere in the cause of deen. And number four was zawjatan tu'inuni fi dunyaya wa akhirati. And O Allah, bless me with such a spouse, such a wife, that makes my stay in this dunya comfortable and ultimately my stay in Jannah blissful. O Allah, I ask you for those four things. In the same breath, in the same light, in the same vein, O Allah, I seek protection from four things. I seek protection, number one, min malin yakunu alayya wabala. O Allah, I seek protection from wealth that takes me away from you. Number two, wa min waladin yakunu alayya zayyida. And O Allah, save me from those children that dominate over the parents and govern the seniors. Save me from such children that become guardians to their own parents. Number three, wa min zawjatin tushayyibuni qabla waqtil mashi. And O Allah, save me from such a wife that makes me age before my time. And number four, wa min jarin law ra'a minni hasanatan katamaha wa law ra'a minni sayyatan fashaha. And O Allah, save me from such a neighbor that when he sees my good, he conceals it. When he sees my mistake, he amplifies it, he magnifies it. What an amazing dua. That Allah, save me from such a person that when he sees my good, he never speaks about it. But let him get a glimpse of my wrong, let him get a glimpse of my evil, which I am full of, and then he goes public with it. He goes public with it. You know, I read a statement in Arabic which caught my eye. And as I was sitting and I thought, let me just share with you, you know, the sentiments and what the thoughts that Allah puts into the heart. In Arabic, they say, كَفَى بِالْمَرْءِ عَيْبًا أَن يَسْتَبِينَ لَهُ مِنَ النَّاسِ. That a man should hide his head in shame if he has the eyesight to recognize the faults of others and he is oblivious of that same fault that is found within his own self. He should hide himself in shame. أَوْ يَمْكُتُ النَّاسُ فِي مَا يَأْتِ مِسْلَى. Or he has that audacity to shun people for crimes that he perpetrates more. So you will say, this man is a womanizer, stay away from him. My brother, how clean is your slate? How clean is your slate? This man, be careful of him. How clean is your slate? So friends and elders, subhanallah, you know, these are, unfortunately, there are certain weaknesses in the ummah. You know, there was this great scholar. So let me just complete this couplet of, like they say in Arabic. And really, this is something that has crippled us. This is something that has paralyzed us as an ummah, where it has become the dedicated agenda to gossip on the wrongs of others. It has become the dedicated agenda. So when the great Luqman the wise, somebody asked him, Luqman, you are so famous, you are so wise, you are so intelligent. Where did you learn all this from? What did he say? I learnt it from those who lacked it. I learnt it from those who lacked it. People said, elaborate, what are you talking about? He says, when I had seen someone doing something wrong, I said, that looks wicked. That looks despicable. That is what I should avoid. If it looks evil to me when he does it, I guess it will look evil to others when I do it. If it looks evil to me when he does it, I guess it will look evil to others when I do it. So he says, I continued in life looking at the faults and the flaws of others. You know, you and I will say this man is sitting in authority. He's abusing his authority. Only to know the day Allah puts me in that position, I am worse than the one who sat before me. You know, the great giant Muhammad bin Idris al-Shafi'i, whom the world till today is indebted to the jurisprudence of Imam Shafi'i. What Imam Shafi'i used to say, he used to say, al-mar'u idha kana aqilan wariha ashghaluhu an uyubi ghayri war'u kama al-alil al-saqim. He says, if a man is intelligent, his own mistakes will keep him occupied so much that he won't have time to look right, he won't have time to look left and search for the faults of others. And then he gives a parable and an example. He said a person meets up in an accident and the person is hospitalized. He goes into the trauma unit. And after he goes into a coma. And after a few days, he comes out of the coma and someone comes to him and he says, my brother, you know, the man who was sleeping on the bed adjacent to you, he passed away tragically yesterday. So you turn around and you tell him that, listen, whether someone died, whether someone is alive, it makes no difference to my life. I am searching and looking for my own cure. Like the great giant, you know, the scholar in America, Sheikh Siraj Wahaj, I mentioned this on many platforms. One day he was preparing his Jumu'ah lecture. Listen to this incident. What an amazing incident. So his young child was interjecting. You know, children are children today. You know, you give them the toy cell phone, they want the real one. You give them the real one, they want the one that you are using. You know, using a pen, you give them another one, no, they want the one that you are using. I mean, that's the temperament and the nature of children. So he was trying to gather his thoughts and put together this Jumu'ah lecture. And his young son was interjecting. So he thought, I need perhaps an hour or two or half an hour to put together this lecture. He opens up a magazine. He finds the map of the world. He tears the page out and he cuts this map of the world into a puzzle. Africa, Asia, China, Europe, South America, North Africa, whatever it is. And he tells his young boy, put the puzzle together. 5 minutes down the line, his son comes. Dad, the puzzle is done. Like they say in English, apples don't fall too far from the tree. So dad said, what you mean it's done? He said, dad, this was a simple puzzle to put together. Don't look at the map of the world. Look behind the map. It was the picture of a man. I put the head in place. I put the nose in place. I put the eyes in place. I put the ears in place. I put the hands in place. I put the feet in place. The father said, my boy, you have taught me the greatest lesson of life. When man comes together, the world will be in order. When man comes together, the world will be in order. Like I spoke about on the first night, you will find fragmentation in the ummah. You might differ with someone, but our hearts need to be united. Our hearts need to be united. And then he goes on to say, Imam Shafi'i, he said, نُعِيبُ الزَّمَانَنَا وَالْعَيْبُ فِينا وَمَا لِزَّمَانِنَا عَيْبٌ سِوَانَا. You know, he says people have the audacity of saying that this one is like this, that organization is like that, that institution is like that. He said, وَالْعَيْبُ فِينَا, for one moment, put the spotlight on yourself and you will realize the biggest problem lies with me and no one else. The biggest problem lies with me and no one else. وَالْعَيْبُ فِينَا, my brothers, if you and I can walk out of the masjid and put the spotlight on ourselves, you know, often it happens, you know, you go home and the wife says, have you heard this, have you heard that? And then ghibah starts from our own homes. Ghibah starts from our own homes. And then Imam Shafi'i, what does he say? He said, وَلَيْسَ الذِّئْبُ يَأْكُلُ لَحْمَ ذِئْبٍ وَيَأْكُلُ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا أَيَانًا. He said a wolf is treacherous, a wolf is sly. This is synonymous to the wolf. A wolf is treacherous and sly. But he says you will never find one wolf preying on another wolf. You will never find a wolf preying on another wolf. He said, what has happened to the paragon of Allah's creation? وَيَأْكُلُ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا عَيَانًا. One human preys on another human. He goes for the jugular. He goes for his blood. دِيَانَتُنَا أَتَّسَنُّ وَالتَّرَاعِي. What does he say? If you paraphrase what Imam Shafi'i says, he said the world today has become like a stage with only actors and no audience. Everyone has become an actor today. Diyanatuna attasannu wa tara'i. But he says behind closed doors, my actions are so wicked. Walau nataqa az-zamanu lana hajana. If only the earth can speak, the earth will testify. From the very inception of the creation of the universe, up to this point, there isn't more wicked humans walking on the back of the earth than those that are walking on the earth today. And then he goes on to say, Lam yabqa fi nasi. I wish you understood the language of Quran. Lam yabqa fi nasi illa al-makru wal-malaku. Shawqun idha damasu zahrun idha ramaku. He said, people from a distance, they look like beautiful blossoming flowers. You know, you walk into a rose garden. What an amazing ambiance. You are intrigued. You are blown away. But he says, no sooner do you get close to that rose garden, you realize there are thorns in that rose. He says, you live in the world. You cannot excommunicate yourself. But he said, be vigilant. Be on your guard. Be vigilant. He said, at times, you need to become a flame. This is what Imam Shafi'i says. You need to be vigilant. You need to be on guard. When the thorn appears before you, you need to burn the thorn before it pricks you. What profound words. You know, Allama Rumi, Jalaluddin Rumi has recorded an example in the Mathnawi that one day one person walks into the marketplace, broad daylight, with a lantern in his hand, and he shines the lantern around. So somebody asked him that, what are you looking for? I'm looking for humans. So he says, these are not animals in the marketplace. These are human beings. He said, what can I tell you? These are not humans. These are the slaves of the egos. These are the slaves of the egos. So what did the Nabi of Allah teach us? I want to share with you two examples from the seerah of the Nabi of Allah. How do we learn to conceal the faults of others? The Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when you're giving a person ghusl, and you find something unsavory, unpleasant on the body, perhaps you find tattoos, do not speak about it. Do not speak about it. I mean, we need to learn to praise people. Like someone said, I don't know why people take flowers to a dead man's grave. It takes the death of a man to acknowledge that he was a good person. Whilst he was alive, you never praised him. Now the man is dead and gone, you're taking flowers to his grave. It takes the death of a man to acknowledge that he was a good person. Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. One day he's parading the streets in Medina tul Munawwara. He's parading the streets in Medina. And in the distance from the home of an elderly Sahabi, he can hear someone singing. So what he does with him was Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He peeps through a small hole. And Sayyidina Umar, he sees this elderly man drinking liquor. And in front of him, there were girls that were singing and dancing. So in a fit of rage, not telling Abdullah bin Mas'ud what is going on, he scales the wall, rushes towards this elderly Sahabi and grabs him by his collar, and he said, "Ma ra'aytuka al-laylati manzaran aqbah min ash-shaykh yantadhiru ajalu." In my entire life, I have not seen a more despicable sight than this. An old man like you, you are drinking liquor. You got women standing and dancing in front of you. One leg is on the grave, and like we will say, the other leg is on the banana peel. You know, you're on your way out and you're drinking liquor and you're looking at women dancing. This elderly man looks at Omar and he said, "What you are saying indeed is correct. I am drinking liquor. I have committed one wrong. But allati sana'ta aqbah, what you have done is worse than what I did. What you have done is worse than what I did. I have drunk liquor. If I make tawbah, Allah will forgive me. You at one time, you broke three orders of Allah. You spied on a Muslim. You looked for the faults of a believer. And you entered the home of a believer without his permission." When Umar heard this, he burst into tears. And he said, "Waylun laka ya Umar, in lam yaghfir laka rabbuk." Oh Umar, if Allah does not forgive you, you're going headlong into the fire of hell. This elderly Sahabi thought to himself that perhaps Umar would have, you know, tainted his reputation, you know, tainted his name. Like I always say, often it happens, my brother, you know, you're walking in the in an office park, you find a man walking out, he jumps into his car. Next moment you see another, a sister walking out, she jumps into the car. What you say, "I smell a rat, bring the cell phone, you know, I'll show him, I got something, I got one on him." I mean, it's not for me to judge. My brother, that is his own sister. The Nabi of Allah is sitting in Atikaf and he's conversing with his honorable consort. Two Sahaba happened to pass by. Nabi alayhi salam said, "Ala rislikuma," just pause. Listen, just for your information, I'm not speaking to a strange woman. This is my legal lawful wife, Safiya. So the Sahaba said, "O Nabi of Allah, we will never entertain such thoughts against you." Nabi alayhi salam said, "I'm afraid the provocation of shaitan will get the better of you. The provocation of shaitan will get the better of you. Ittaqu mawadi at-tuhma. Avoid a platform of accusation." So nonetheless, this elderly Sahabi, for 1 month, he stays away from the majlis of Umar. After 1 month, lengthy narration, long story short, Umar radiallahu anhu is in Masjid al-Nabawi. This elderly Sahabi, he covers his face and he enters the masjid. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he calls one of his companions. He said, "Ali, hadha shaykh, there's an elderly gentleman sitting at the back. Kindly tell him to come closer." That elderly man, after 1 month, he comes in front of Sayyidina Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. Umar radiallahu ta'ala looks at him, "Udhnu minni," come closer to me. "Udhnu minni udhunak," bring your ears closer to me. And then he whispers into his ears, "Walladhi ba'atha Muhammadan bil haqqi nabiyya, ma akhbartuhu ahadan minan nas, billadhi ra'aytu fi hadhihi al-layla, wa ibn mas'ud fa innahu kana ma'i." By the qasam of that being who has sent Muhammad as his true messenger, I swear by Allah, I have not disgraced you in the least bit. I have not told anyone about you. Abdullah bin Mas'ud was with me. He too does not know. This elderly Sahabi tells Umar, "Udhnu minni udhunak," bring your ears closer to me. "Faltaqama udhuna," as though he makes a morsel out of his ear. And he says, "Walladhi," he whispers into the ears of Umar, "Walladhi ba'atha Muhammadan bilhaqqi nabiyya," by Allah's qasam, that Allah who had sent Muhammad as his true messenger, since that day I have not touched liquor again. Since that day, I have not touched liquor again. Umar radiallahu anhu started yelling, "Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar." Sahaba began to wonder, "What has happened? Allahu Akbar." Umar radiallahu anhu said, "This is between him and me. It's not for your consumption. I mean, give it to the media. They will sensationalize it. I mean, we look what happens today. I mean, WhatsApp. This is one of the biggest fitnas today. You know, information is disseminated. I always say in this day and age, few nights ago, my brother's Quran is not for entertainment. Unfortunately, we have not studied the language of Quran. We have barred ourselves from volumes of Islamic knowledge. The Quran says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe, in ja'akum fasiqum, when you receive some information, the first thing you need to do, fatabayyanu, you need to verify the information. Don't condemn anyone. I mean, don't judge anyone in the world. It's not for me to judge. It's not for you to judge. Really, my brothers, when you know someone is doing something wrong, make dua for that man. Make dua for his guidance. Don't expose the wrong. Got nothing to do with your life. Abu Ayyub Ansari, he comes home and his wife comes to him and she says, this rumor against our mother Aisha is being circulated. What is your opinion? So, you know, many a times we come home, the wife says, you heard this, you heard that, and ghibah starts from our own homes. So Abu Ayyub Ansari, he looks at his wife, and he said that, you are my wife. Will you ever commit an act of immorality? She says, me, I would never do that. If you will never do that, Aisha being the wife of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, do you think she will ever do something like that in her life? And he said, in my life, I don't want to ever hear you saying things like that again. You know, the Nabi of Allah was very sensitive when it came to the material things of this dunya. Nabi alayhi salam, you know, he overlooked. You know, my brother, you know what happens? You know, you go shopping at times and the wife tells you 5 minutes. You know what the 5 minutes means? You know, you're going visiting somewhere and, you know, we leave in 5 minutes. I mean, 5 minutes to stand up, 5 minutes to take a few steps. And by the time you leave, it's almost 2 hours. Subhanallah. So the Nabi of Allah was accommodating. And we spoke about this last night. This was the tolerant nature of the Nabi of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salam was accommodating. But when it came to matters of deen, this is where you don't bend the rules. Allahu Akbar, the Nabi of Allah is sitting with our mother Aisha. And she passes a comment about Safiya. Hasbuka min Safiya kada wa kada. That, O Nabi of Allah, your wife Safiya, you know, she's so short, there's no good in her. You know, she was the daughter of Huyay ibn Akhtab, a very senior Jew. So Safiya, she was very short. So, you know, Aisha used to pass these sarcastic comments. Nabi alayhi salam became so upset. He said, oh Aisha, laqad kulti kalima lanajasatil bahru. You have uttered such a statement which potentially could contaminate the oceans of the entire world. Which potentially could contaminate the oceans of the entire world. Brothers and sisters, my message to you is, let us learn to conceal the faults of others. No matter who the person is, Allah Ta'ala save us. One of the biggest problems in the ummah today is jealousy. Allah Ta'ala save me, Allah save one and all. Otherwise, the ulama have written in kitabs that jealousy is most commonly found amongst the scholars and the learned. Malik bin Dinar used to say, Shahadatul Qurra maqboola fi kulli shay illa shahadatu ba'dihim ala ba'din. That I will accept the evidence of a scholar openly, provided one learned scholar does not give evidence against another learned scholar. If one learned scholar of deen gives evidence against another learned scholar, he says, I'm afraid it will be contaminated with jealousy. Really, my brothers, you know when jealousy grips a person? I thought I'd just digress for 2 minutes. This thought crosses, you know, sometimes when you speak and these thoughts cross the mind. I will just share this with you. Wallahi, when a person is overtaken with, when a person becomes jealous, Sayyidina Musa radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Jalilul Qadr, Nabi of Allah. Who was Musa alayhi salam? He was the cousin of Qarun. Allah Ta'ala speaks about him in the Quran. Inna Qaruna kana min qawmi Musa fabagha alayhim. His cousin and his father, Musa alayhi salam's father, were brothers. He was given the privilege of communicating on Mount Tur. When Musa received the Torah, Qarun was amongst those 70 people. That's not all. And Qarun had memorized the Torah by memory. Understand the privileges that Allah had given him. But jealousy gripped the heart of Qarun. What was the jealousy? Why is my cousin Musa a prophet? And why am I not a prophet? So what he does, Qarun, there was an immoral woman that was living in that locality. So he tells her that, listen, the next time Moses stands up to address a congregation, I want you to embarrass him. I want you to tell him, hey, Moses, you are giving big lectures. You have committed zina with me. You're playing with the friend of Allah. Musa alayhi salam stands up. This woman says, you rather sit down. You committed adultery with me. You're playing with the friend of Allah. Musa alayhi salam goes to one side. He falls in sajda. فَسَمِعَ النَّاسُ سَوْتًا فِيهِ جَلَالَ النُّبُوَّةِ The awe of prophethood was being disseminated. There was a loud scream. Musa alayhi salam stands up. He looks at this woman and he said, tell me, when did I ever touch you? When did I ever come close to you? She says, forgive me. Qarun provoked me because of his jealousy for you. Allah, Musa alayhi salam turns to Allah. He said, oh me Allah, if I am your Nabi, show me how you take revenge. Allah said, Musa, the land is at your command. If the land is at my command, solo Qarun. فَخَصَفْنَا بِهِ وَبِدَارِهِ الْأَرْضِ Nabi alayhi salam said, he will continue sinking right up to the day of Qiyamah. Understand, a man who was the cousin of Musa, who was given the privilege of communicating with Allah on Mount Tur. He had memorized the Torah by memory, but as a result of jealousy, he died as a disbeliever, and the entire world witnessed what happened to him. Coming to the incident of Umar, and I will just terminate on this. You know, one day Sayyidina Umar was giving a discourse in Medina, and he was a very sensitive person. And he gets this foul smell. You know, somebody had, passed wind. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he becomes upset. And he said, whoever had done that, kindly get up and move out of the gathering. One person was sitting on the right of Umar. He tapped Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. I mean, my brother, you know, you are sitting in a position of authority. If somebody has to make a suggestion to you, who the hell are you to tell me? Don't you know who I am? Umar was sitting. He said, my brother, can I tell you something, O Umar? Go ahead. Why are you embarrassing this man? Why don't you rather tell everyone to go out, and those who have wudu, they can make a fresh wudu. Those who don't have wudu, they can make a new wudu. At least in this way, people won't look at that man with dirty eyes. Umar radiallahu anhu said, my brother, today you have taught me the greatest lesson of life. Today you have taught me the greatest lesson of life. Allah Ta'ala grant us the tawfiq and the ability. There's so much more I could have told you. You know, like they say in English, if a person will harp upon his achievement, then most definitely you will achieve deficiency in life. Consider others to be better than you. Our mother Aisha was asked, when can I consider myself to be good? She said, as long as you consider yourself to be evil, remember you are the best that is walking on Mother Earth. Allah Ta'ala grant us the tawfiq and the ability that we can take lessons from these amazing examples from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba. Inshallah, we thank Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala for affording us with this opportunity. You know, I've been here for the last 3 days. It's been absolutely amazing. You know, we request you to make dua for us. Bi-ithnillah, if we meet again, inshallah we will meet. If not in this world, in nahnu aishna, fahuwa yajma'u baynana. Wa in nahnu mutna, falqiyamatu tujma'. Inshallah, if we meet in this world, we will meet. If not, then the plains of Hashar will reunite us. Inshallah. Barakallahu feekum.